Welcome to the Peace of Authenticity podcast. I'm Aubrey.
I'm Jordan.
And this is Gray.
And we are the Andersons. Thank you so much for continuing to support our podcast here on YouTube.
And we're just so thankful that you're on here and you're joining in on the conversation with us. We really hope and pray that this encourages you and inspires you to draw closer to our Lord and that you have an awesome time chatting with us.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Peace of Authenticity podcast, and we are so excited to have our awesome friends, the Johnsons, Shayla and Travis, here with us. And we've actually been wanting to have them on here for a while, and so we're just really excited for what they have to say.
Yeah, it's gonna be good. We're gonna just jump right into it for everybody that's listening. We're not gonna waste any time. So why don't you guys just give us a quick breakdown of where it is that you've been and what, you know, kind of led you to this spot right here.
Wow, that is a long road.
Yeah, just real quick though.
Short and sweet. 60 seconds.
60 seconds. Man, it's been a path of a few years of just trying to figure out where God is trying to lead our family specifically. Mm. And in the season that we're in right now is, to be real with you, I probably don't know as well as Shayla probably knows, but man, we're just trying to be obedient to what God is leading our family into right now. And it's a little bit gray right now, but that's okay.
Yeah.
Hopefully you walk into the right space.
Yeah, for sure. I think God's really been teaching us that even in the middle of not knowing anything, He can wreck like different perspectives, and where you thought you were headed is not where He's got you going. So it's been quite an interesting journey.
Yeah, well, I mean, I just have to say, for real, you guys don't know Travis and Shayla like we do, but I will say that when they say when God has something for our family, they mean it. Like, their family is a tight-knit group.
Yeah.
It's really cool to see. I hope that one of these days we're as super tight with our family as
well.
What
and
you guys
I was joking with Shayla earlier, like probably like a few weeks ago, and I was like, I've never seen like a mom and daughter just be like actually really good friends. And it's like the coolest thing ever. Like, I want that whenever we have a daughter for to have that kind of relationship. But seriously, there's like a grace on you guys with family. Like, it was just really apparent, especially whenever your kids came to that retreat that we went to and we got to see you guys like interact with them as like a whole, like what Aubrey was talking about, a unified family, which is kind of sadly pretty rare.
It is. Yeah. Family is like so important to us. I think it's really one of the most important things in our life. It's something that we truly value. It's something that we've had to make a lot of sacrifices for. It's something that we purposely choose to put above other things. I think in today's culture, family kind of gets put on the back burner in a lot of areas, even in the church setting. For a mom especially, I know that I was constantly like, hey, keep your family second. But at the same time, I'm like, man, that's God's greatest mission for us. Family is huge for us.
Yeah, it's been our goal, like really from the very beginning. She's been a stay-at-home mom, like the entire time that we've had kids. And there's been different points in time where people have said, are your kids really coming to this? Or can't you leave them somewhere else? We made it where we want our kids pretty much everywhere we're at all the time. And sometimes people look at you a little bit wacky. I mean, we're all not.
I just feel like if they can't be included, then I don't want to be included.
Wow.
You know, and there's so much that I think adults forget that children learn through watching you. And I want my children around other adults that are growing in Christ. Like, I want them to see struggles. I want them to see that adults deal with things too.
Yeah.
Like, I don't want life to like smack them in the face when they turn 18 and go on into college. Like, I want them seasoned and trained up and just comfortable with the mission as a child.
Yeah. Yes, yes. That's so good. And something that I think comes hand in hand with like a family dynamic is also identity.
Yes.
And isn't that what you were talking about earlier when we were eating? You said something about identity. I was like, oh dang, like this is
like,
so
one
good.
One of the most important things that I feel like God's really put on my heart is that family is a place where you should be fully known and fully loved.
Yes.
And that if every family could just focus on that, that way, like all your flaws, all the things that you feel insecure about, when you're fully known then and feel fully loved, I feel like that just catapults you into so much growth. So it like, I see so many teens and young adults that still struggle with being fully known and fully accepted and fully loved. And I'm just like, man, if we could get a hold of that in family units and grab onto where everyone has that place, and then it's easier to pour that out to others, to our friends, to people that are part of our church. That way, we already know how to do it.
Yeah, something interesting I could add to that is, like, here lately I've been thinking about what guilt and shame look like in our lives. And for our kids specifically, I know, unfortunately for me, a lot of times I honestly turn to, like, shame for whatever reason, where Shayla can turn around and, like, man, we want you to be in a comfortable place right now. There's no shame here. Sure, you might be guilty of doing a certain thing, but we're not going to put shame on you right now. And it's for, she's extremely good at recognizing, hey, we want you to know that, sure, you might be guilty today, but, like shame is not something that we're going to carry in this family.
Wow.
Yeah.
I want them to always feel, like, open. I never want anything off limits. Nothing. So that, like, if the enemy comes to attack them in some way, shape, or form, or they mess up, which, let's be real, we're all humans. We're going to mess
up. It's going
to
happen.
You know? I'm just like, come to me. Like, let me work through it with you. I can't always fix everything, but I can love you through this. Like, I can, like, we can pull through. And this isn't going to, like, tag on and stick to you for life.
Yeah.
And even that saying, you know, like, you'll see it in movies, and I've probably actually heard some of my friends say when I was younger, oh my gosh, my parents are going to kill me. And so they keep things from them, right? Like, even whenever they're little, like, I've done it before, where I would break something. It's somehow found its way under my bed, hidden under something else, you know? And it's just like you talking about that fact that they can come to me. They know that I am a safe place where, yes, there is guilt there, but we're not going to put shame on it. And then whenever you are talking about that, I've even thought about that saying shame on you. And I'm like, that's kind of like word curses on somebody when you say that.
Yeah.
And like, why do people say that? It's like a manipulation, like shame on you. You should feel bad.
You
for
should
doing
feel
that.
Terrible about what you just did. Yeah. Even though we all mess up, right?
Yeah, like you're saying. All do. So parents often wonder why they don't have a close relationship with their children as they get older. It's because there's never been a fully open, fully accepting space there.
Yeah.
They know, like, oh crap, dad's going
to
kill me.
I can't talk to them about
that. I want
that.
My kids to be like, oh crap, I need to call my parents.
Yes.
Like, that's what I want them
to
do. I want them to immediately be like, hey, I know someone's going to be on my side. Someone's going to at least tell me, like, hey, okay, we messed up here, and this is what we got to do to fix it. This is where we got to go from here. And that's what I want them to lean into. And even little bitty things with, like, parents and kids, like, if they got busted telling a lie or something, I would never identify them with their mess up. Like, it's never like, oh man, you're a liar or something like that.
Yes.
Like, hey, lying is wrong. We don't like that. But it was never calling them the sin.
Yes.
It's just calling out the mistake, not calling them the mistake.
Oh. Yeah, and that's good. That's good. But okay, so tell me where both of you guys growing up, like, family is very important to both of you. And it's obvious. It just kind of, I mean, just the way that you walk it out. I mean, because that's how I see people is if you walk it out, don't just talk about it, but is it evident in your life? Because that's what makes the biggest difference. What is it from the way that you guys were raised that made this switch happen in your mind that was like, well, I was raised like this, but I really want to be like this.
Or even I was raised like this, so I, considering that, I would love to do this.
Yeah, I would love, I much rather would have had it like this, you know, like what was the switch there that you made?
Yeah, for me growing up, I mean, our family, my mom loved me. It wasn't one of those things. She just worked a lot. So there was just a lot of different situations where I was staying somewhere else, my aunt's house, my grandma's, a bunch of different things. And I know that that's not what we want for our family. Like, we wanted it cohesive all of the time. And not to bash on my family or anything like that, but that just wasn't there
whenever
I was young. So now at this point, I'm like, how often can I be there for my kid or for my family or whatever that looks like? So just to keep that going down that path, man, I'm singly mindedly focused on that right now.
Really were. Like, his mom was a single mom, so she was working multiple jobs to keep, you know, the kids able to do everything that they wanted to do. And that's hard because that a lot of women don't have that option to be stay-at-home moms. It's not there. And I think just from the beginning when we decided to have kids, and it was rough. Like, there were times where we didn't have two pennies to rub together. But what we were confident in was that I was called to stay at home and keep the family strong and full of love. Like, our children would never have any idea that we were poor as dirt when we started out, you know?
Right, yeah.
Like, they
yeah.
had no clue.
Yeah,
that's and awesome. It was like, every day was full of life and fun.
Yeah.
And I can even remember at one point telling Travis, I was like, well, when you come home, I can get a part-time job in the evenings. Mm-hmm. And he was like, no. He was like, I don't want that. He's like, if life is going to suck for one of us, I'm going to get two jobs so that, you know, we can keep this going. And it's just evident, like, how much he craved, like, keeping the family together and keeping mom at home with the kids. And we just made it work. But, like, for me growing up, my home was broken. Like, my parents divorced really early. And I don't know if that's, like, what initiated the feed in me of, like, how important family was, just to be together. And my brother and I were, like, best friends growing up. Like, every injury I incurred was probably from something he rooted me on to.
Yeah.
So, even to this day, though, my mom and I, we are so close. Like, I would consider her now a friend also, not just a mother.
Yeah.
And, family's super important to me, and I want that for my kids. And I've always had an open relationship with my mom. She encouraged that. There was nothing off topic.
Yeah.
Like, I could ask her the most inappropriate or the weirdest questions, and she took them all. You know?
Yeah. Oh, my gosh.
She's like, ask me. Like, yeah. I would rather you ask me. And growing up, I'm like, I'm so glad you did that for me.
Wow.
And so I do the same thing for the kids. And sometimes the kids are like, man, mom, you keep things so weird.
Oh, I love it.
I love that.
Yeah. Really? Well, because it's like, you know, growing up, my dad was a pastor. And so, you know, we were like the typical preacher's kids. And so there were definitely subjects that we don't talk about that, you know. Yeah. You'll go to hell for talking about that. But I mean, you know, but it was just kind of like, you know, you don't do this because you'll go to hell. You don't do that because you'll go to hell. And there was never any of those, but you know, there was never a time where, you know, the parents would just sit down and be like, okay, what do you want to know? And answer that and get that big question mark out of the back of your mind. Because I've always wondered why. I have to know the why behind everything that I do or don't do. Okay, well, why? You know? But instead, it was just kind of like, hey, no, we don't talk about, you don't do that, and we don't talk about it.
Well, and I think even like a lot of kids that say why, people consider that being defiant. But it's like, no, they just really want to understand. Like Aubrey, you love to understand how things work, and you want to process. Yeah. And I think a lot of the time, whenever you're younger, by some of the stories you told me, they thought it was defiant. Like, he'd get a spanking, you know? It's
like, I was headed to hell real fast. Every day. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just like, I feel like... we always talk about discipleship and how important that is in the church, right? But I think a lot of people don't connect discipleship and family, but that is what discipleship is. Yeah. And so many times, you know, you're talking about how you keep things weird, and you'll just, hey, sit down, ask me anything, I will answer, like, let's go. Some parents are like, la, 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 don't want to know. Are you doing anything? I don't want to know. Yeah. You know,
or they overhear their kids talking about stuff, and they're just like, well, I'm just going to pretend like that's not happening.
Yeah.
You know?
And so it's like, oh, what's that saying? They keep their heads in the sand.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they just don't know how to do it.
It's just, rip the band-aid off. Like, you know, like, I tell Colin, it's only weird if you want it to be weird. Like, but I need them to know, and like, leading small groups and youth groups, their kids need to know things way sooner than you even think. Let's just be way sooner. And they would come, and they would ask me questions, and I'm like, well, have you talked to your parents about this? And they're like, no. You know, and I'm just
I would
okay,
never.
Well, there's the red flag right there. Like,
storks still bring babies at our house. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, and they're teenagers.
like how you were saying, you need to know why our son is like that.
Yeah.
And if parents can change their perspective of seeing that as annoying and they just can't accept what they're saying, you can save your child a lot of heartache because they're going to figure out that why themselves if you can't explain it to them. And it's like when we talk about alcohol or drinking or anything like that, that I'm like, you know, it's not wrong to drink alcohol. Mm-hmm. It's these people that are ensnared in addictions. And we were passing a bar that happens to be on the corner of where our house is. And my little sister, who I watch, always says, is that the jail? And
because the bars on
the it's not bars. Like, it looks like on the window. And I'm like, no. But then my daughter says, well, it's could be kind of like a spiritual bar. And so I'm just like, you get it. Like, she's thinking on a deeper level.
Yeah.
But like, Wow. It's not something like a physical bar, but it could be something that's like spiritually ensnaring some people. So I like, that's what I want our kids to get to. Mm. I want them to have a deeper understanding to where they don't go seek it out and just try to figure it out.
And you took it further than just don't do that.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I think that's what's so important with parents to explain, but why though? Why can't I do this? And it's like, that's how she got it. She's like, that is like prison, actually. Like, it's a spiritual prison because it's like a chain connected.
Yes.
Yeah. You can't get away from. And so if you wouldn't have had that conversation with her, she'd be like, oh, we don't talk about that. That's nothing we talk about. It's bad. Don't ever do it. Don't even think about it. You know?
Well, yeah. But then you also find, you know, like in my scenario, I would go to other people's houses. I would go to my friend's house for mm-hmm. birthday parties and stuff. And I would see alcohol at their house. And I would immediately be thinking, all these people are going to hell. Yeah. All of them. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Because I didn't know the why. I was just told, yep, if you drink alcohol, you're going to hell. And so then I'm sitting here going, oh my gosh, all my friends' parents are going to hell.
You're like,
you know
this
what I mean?
Stinks.
I'm saying, is anyone going to heaven? You know?
No one's going to heaven.
Right.
And see that crazy confusion that just got blown out of proportion just because something wasn't fully explained.
Right, because parents don't like uncomfortable conversations.
Yeah. Yeah. Right.
Travis is like a master at this. He constantly is like, have uncomfortable conversations.
I want to make it as uncomfortable as I possibly can. Just because if you get comfortable in the uncomfortable zone, man, it gets a lot more comfortable.
That's true. And like, man, that's like, and also the fact of like living life, if you're super comfortable all the time, something's wrong. Like, and it's even what you were talking about at the very beginning. You were talking about like, it's obedience. We're trying to find, you know, we're finding the path of just obedience. We're obeying where the Lord takes us. And that's been something that lately we've noticed in our podcast when we talk to people. It's about obedience. Like, does it look weird? Sure. Will people question it? Yeah. Are people going to this and that? It's obedience though. So I'm just going to do what the Lord's called me to do and not worry about what people think.
Yeah. And it just goes to say, if God knows us all well enough, he knows the numbers of hairs on our head, right? Yeah. Before you were born, I knew you, as the Bible says. Don't you think that it's specific that all of us are trying to move into obedience, but we're all doing different things? Like you said, we might be in a gray area right now too, but and you guys are as well.
Yeah.
But yours is like, the Lord has really made us hone in on family and what that looks like. What does he have for all four of us? Not just Travis and Shayla, but including the kids in there as well, because they're a huge part of it. And you guys are focused on something else and we're focused on something else. But it is all moving toward obedience. And if God knows us all individually that much and cares that much, why wouldn't everybody's assignment be different in different seasons, right?
That's true. Mm-hmm.
And so I think that it's cool because we could even bring the kids in. They're right there in the other room. They're probably sitting here going, oh.
They're like, if he...
They're talking about us. They're awesome. But I just think that it's incredible. And I would really like to give practical things for people that are listening to this. Like show us some practicality of what it looks like to... I mean, a lot of people say, well, I'm not discipling anybody, but I'm raising kids. But here's the difference.
That's what that is.
Raising kids versus discipling kids is different. So what I want to do is for somebody that's watching this, it's like, man, I really want to shift something in my home. I don't feel like we're growing together spiritually. Mm-hmm. I feel like, you know, we are successful in business. We are successful, and my kids are getting older. They're maturing, but they're not really pressing into the spiritual side of things. What do you guys have for that person?
Do you want to go first?
Yeah, so for me, specifically with Colin, because there are seasons with Colin, just like it is for me, like where, man, he's digging into the Word and like he's going deep. Same thing for me. But then there's other seasons where it's like, man, I'm just not really feeling this all that much right now. So I think, honestly, what it came down for with me and Colin is I've just got to be extremely intentional about making sure that, hey, we're not doing this just to check this off the list, bro. Like, we're doing this more to find out who Jesus is and who he is in our lives and who he wants us to be through that.
Wow.
So it just comes down to the almost, I don't want to say a grind, but just like the intentionality of making sure that we're getting into God's word every single day, praying and learning what we can learn from God. And if I'm being real with you, Shayla has done a lot more than I have when it comes to helping these kids figure out who they are in Christ. I feel like a lot of times whenever I come home, I'm kind of the enforcer, and I'm like, hey, we got to make sure we're doing all this.
Yeah.
And she's really just pouring into them all day long. So she's done way more than I have, if I'm being real.
No. Discipleship is comes from living life too. They see you. So it's because of you they know what a Christian man is modeled like. For like how he was talking with like Colin digging into the word, we homeschool too. So one thing how I started with my kids, so if you have really small kids, I would start by reading a chapter out of the Bible every day with them. I would read it to them, or you can even pull up the Bible app and hit play. Like if you have a hard time deciphering words or whatever, sounding them out, it'll play for you. You can pick out one or two things, and I would sit there and be like, well, what jumped out at you? Like, what, do you have any questions about this? And it could be the weirdest question, and that's okay, because I'm like, go ahead and ask me. You know, when we were reading through Old Testament law, Colin was like, if I hear, put your head on, hand on a bull's head, and then you slaughter it, or get to it. And I was like, doesn't that make you thankful for Jesus?
So thankful.
There you go.
You don't realize what all you were saying, bro. So we would do that, and then something with my kids, if they were struggling in a certain area, I would intentionally pick out certain resources, like certain books, certain programs, for them to read on their own that was just for them. So let's say like they were having a problem with like bad attitudes or something. Well, when you put two kids together that are fighting that have bad attitudes towards each other, it's hard to get them to open up to one another. So I would separate them out and be like, hey, here's, I want you to read this book. We're going to talk about this book. Let's focus on, my kids read 10 pages a day, so y'all can do more or less, whatever you want. And then Emery would underline questions that she had, or she'd be like, can you explain this to me? Like, I don't really agree with this statement. Do you? So it not only like re-solidifies what they believe, but it also re-solidifies what our values are as a family. So you can start out with, I would say, digging into the word together. If you've never done it before, don't feel like you need to have all the answers. I tell my kids all the time, I'll have to ask Jesus when I get there. Because there's some stuff you just don't, right? And so dig in together, question stuff together. Like, let your kids know it's okay that you have questions too. Because I don't want them to think that we have everything 100% figured out, and that if they don't, something's wrong. I want them to know it's okay that you can question. And then we pray together as a family every single night. So if you're not doing that, maybe that should be the very first place you start. And we take turns. Like every night it's someone else in the family's turn to pray over the family. And we hold hands in a circle, and y'all would laugh, but our dogs legit sit in the circle with us.
They know.
They know it's prayer time. And after prayer time, we give hugs and kisses goodnight, and our dog legit jumps up for hugs.
Oh my gosh.
She's trained. It's so weird.
I love it so much.
So we're just not just discipling our kids. We're discipling
ourselves.
Y'all just taking it to the next level.
All dogs go to heaven. So.
Yeah, I've heard that. I think it was a movie.
Ours are going to have to live with Jordan. So,
we've already talked about this.
Yeah, because we were like, you know, when you get to heaven, you have your mansion. I'm not going to have pets in there, so the dogs are going to have to go live over there. No.
I love that so much, because what I heard through what you guys were saying was there is accountability. It's not just go get it done. It's go get it done. I'm going to ask you about it. I want you to come to me with questions. I want to get information from you so you can get information from me. So that's exactly what discipleship is with kids. Because like even I've even noticed sometimes with Gray, I'm like, can you just like sit here, and I'm going to go and I need a breather, which of course all parents do, but it's just like, don't like pawn your child off so that you can get something. If that makes sense. Like it's like there, it's so much more beautiful. It can be so much more like thriving and flourishing. Like your kid doesn't have to hate you.
No, they really don't. And Sunday morning, if you go to Sunday morning church, that is not enough. You can't eat one little tiny meal and sustain a whole week and think your body's going to grow.
That's so
same
true.
Same thing spiritually. But I would also suggest, so your kids don't hate you, like give them a chance to grow. Give them an opportunity. So with our kids, like their input matters. Like I care about your opinion. Do you like this? Do you not like this? Is this something that you would enjoy? Of course, some people take it to extremes. And it's like their kids run their family. Don't do that. Their opinions are heard. And there's many times where I'm like, I hear that you don't like this, but this is something you need to do. Like you're
yes, like I hear you.
Growing, but I understand this is hard for you. You don't enjoy this, but this is something that, you know, you need. Or there's times where I'm like, okay, like, thank you for letting me know that you legitimately have zero desire in this area. I will not push that on you. Like, I don't want you to resent this growing up. And so it's literally give your children a chance to make mistakes. Give them a voice. Let them be known in your house. Let them let their opinions matter. Like so many parents are like, oh, I'm the parent. You're the child. Don't say anything.
Yeah.
Be seen, not heard.
And whenever you're saying all that, Shayla, I just got this picture in my head because you're talking about growth and thriving. And I saw a plant and it was thriving, but it couldn't get any bigger than where it was put in the pot. Right. And so as parents, you're like, okay, it's time to move up, give you some more space to grow. And I think a lot of the times parents are like, no, we don't want to let you go. You have to stay here. And all of a sudden they keep them so close, they're not able to fully flourish the way that they're supposed to. You know, you can even see that with, what's that saying? Helicopter parents, helicopter mom, right? Like I'll see that with Gray sometimes. If a kid's like says something, I'm like, I'm gonna kill you. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, Gray doesn't care. He doesn't know. He's two. But it's like just okay. How if he asks me questions, you know, when he gets older about why someone treated him this way or why you know so and so happened, you know, all these different things, I can actually give him an answer and I'll be like, no, honey, you're so perfect and precious. I don't know why that ever happened. Right. You know what I mean? And it's like giving them that space to grow.
I feel like I'm a helicopter mom, but I sit back a little.
You go
it's
in.
It's like my kid, have you seen the cute little pictures where there's like a cute little cub with the like ferocious mom lions in the background? Yes. So I'm just like letting my kids go and play and make their choices and mistakes, but at any second I will bite your face off.
You're like, I'll kill
my babies.
So basically on a weekly basis, you know, Cole and I will do a Bible study together and pretty much at the beginning I'm like, hey man, do you want to do this? And I give him an option if he wants to do it or not. And every single time he's like, yeah, I do want to do this. Mm. Like he's a little bit reluctant sometimes because he doesn't want to put the work in. But every time he chooses it, because I'm like, I can't choose what your relationship looks like with Jesus. Like only you can make that choice. And he shows yes every single time up to this point. So I'm super proud of him.
It gives them a voice. It's not just like you're cramming Jesus down their throat. They're accepting it. And they're like, okay, I have a choice in this. Instead of like a kid getting to college and being like, well, is this what I believe or is this what my parents believe? Let them flex their spiritual muscles while they're under your care. Yes. Like where you can gently guide them back on the right track because they're going to wander off about 50 million times just like adults do. And then I think that teaches them to trust you too. Like, hey, mom believes in me. Dad believes in me. And I know I'm going to mess up, but I know that it's going to be okay.
Wow. That makes me think, because you're talking about going to college. I've heard so many times these kids that go to church every Sunday because, let's be honest, their parents make them and all this stuff. And then they go to college. First of all, they party it up like it's the weekend every day. But then they also listen to what their professors say because they're just used to listening what people tell them and they believe it, right? So now you're around your professors every day. You only hear from your mom once a week sort of thing. And so, hey, you know what? Maybe God's not real. Now that I'm thinking about it, I've never really felt the goosebumps at church that my mom made me get. You know, all these different things. And so because of that growth that you are allowing, you know, you guys are allowing your kids to have, they won't have that identity crisis to where all of a sudden, well, yeah, I was a Christian last week, but this month I'm an atheist.
Right.
Because my tire went flat on the side of the road, you know? It's just
Yeah, I think it's important, you know, that the Bible talks about you train up a child, right, in the way that they should go. So when they get older, they will not depart from it. A lot of people think that, well, as long as my kids are children, I can drag them to church.
Kicking and screaming.
So when they get older, I will have done my job. You know, instead of sitting here going, listen, it's my job to train up a child to hear the voice of the Lord, to seek after the guidance of the Holy Spirit, right? And to develop that relationship on their own, because my merited relationship with Jesus cannot get my children into heaven.
It's true.
And so when the Bible is clear and it says train up a child, people think, oh, well, I made sure my kids were at church every Sunday morning and I made sure they were at youth on Wednesday nights. Do you know how many youth kids over the 6 years that we were in youth ministry, how many of them still attend church and still serve the Lord and still do everything? Well, because their parents were making them be there, they weren't ever taught who Jesus was. I mean, was there seeds planted? Absolutely. I don't believe that there's never any conversation that we have. There's always a seed that's planted in somebody's heart. But it wasn't training them up to be like, this is who Jesus is. And you need to know that. Because like you're saying, one service a week is not going to be enough. You can't just go and pray once a week and be sustained.
Well, it's even like, I love that scripture, train up a child. Whenever you train for something, this is a daily intentional thing, right? Yeah. You're like, I've been training for a marathon for a year, so once a week I run about a mile.
Right.
You gonna die in this marathon.
I just think about, like, it'd be like trying to teach a child how to ride a bike by riding it for them.
Yeah.
Like, if they're just gonna stand there and watch you say, okay, I'm gonna ride this, and then you're gonna know how to ride it because I'm riding it in front of you. No, you gotta get them on and teach them how to pedal, how to balance. And if you don't let them do that, like, even stuff that y'all don't agree with, like, there's all, like, sermons, messages, we'll hash it out. We're like, do you agree with that? What did you think about this? Mm-hmm. Like, do you actually think people follow this? Like, get into the nitty-gritty with kids so that their faith can root. Instead of just this, well, we heard the message, y'all just take it for what it is and see you next week. Like, it's got to be more real. Mm-hmm. It has to be.
Wow.
So you guys said something when we were at that retreat. You said, like, that you want your kids to see the success and the struggles. So, like, your house is transparent, like, completely. Like, you want them to know the things that you're struggling with, but you also want them to know that you succeed. What does that look like in a healthy balance?
I don't know if we could probably describe a healthy balance because our kids are all in on pretty much everything. Yeah. So they've seen the super ugly and they've seen the really, really good. Like, they see everything as bad. I don't think there's very much of anything that we keep back from our kids, which some people wouldn't agree with that. And you do what's right for your kid and for your family. But for us, man, we let it all hang out.
We just feel like it has really made them stronger. It's made them more just aware of reality. Like, when they come into the world, they're going to know. When I have a bad day, my kids know. When I mess up, I tell them I'm sorry. Like, I'm not a parent that's too proud that's like, oh, I'm the parent. I'm just like, man, I had a really crappy attitude today. I'm sorry. I'm always telling y'all not to have a bad attitude, and here I am, like, hacked off at the world today. You know, and if we fight, if we have, like, if our family's struggling in any kind of area, like, our kids know. They know my struggles. Like, I personally struggle with anxiety. My kids see the downside of that. They see the upside of that. They see where the really dark struggle of it is also beautiful, because my kids know that even when I have a low or I'm really struggling, they see me clinging to Jesus. And I want them to see that. And I want them to see someone that always fights back for Jesus, like, to get back to Jesus. And so we haven't really come across anything that I feel like is too much for them. Even when we had lived in Shawnee for a while, the homeless population was a lot bigger there. The mental health issues were a lot bigger there, but they saw it all and were just like, man, this is real life. These are really people that are really struggling, that are lost, that like, these people exist everywhere, and I don't want you to be sheltered from that.
Yeah, we would never put our kids in a precarious situation where they would be put into harm, but man, we let them see everything.
Yeah.
That way they know what real life looks like whenever it hits
your
face. We were in small groups where we had Christian brothers and sisters talking about, like, hey, I'm struggling to stay sober. I'm struggling to not want to do drugs. And I want my kids to know that. Like, I want them to know that we're all people. We're all beloved children of God. And, like, I don't want labels to define that person. And I want them to know that, like, even grown-ups are fighting their way to heaven. Like, we're fighting to stay on this narrow path.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, it's so much more real and beautiful when you can be a little bit more transparent. Like, when kids can see that, they don't have this expectation of perfection. Like, we have Jesus now, so we are completely
all of a sudden, magically.
Everything is perfect. Like, I want them to, like, see reality.
Right. The realness.
Yeah.
But I don't want Jesus to ever be questioned to them because they walk out in the real world and see it. Like, Jesus never said, hey, your life's going to be perfect. We're going to have struggles and persecution. And I want them to see that we're all fighting.
Yeah.
And to have, I feel like those people are role models for our children, because when they see that, I'm like, look how hard they're fighting. I'm like, every single day they're struggling and fighting. They're like, they're hanging in for the good fight. And I want you to see that, because that's real to me.
Wow. I love that. And there's something else too about both of you guys. Your lives, of course, you're all a family, but your lives look different in the way that, like, you working Travis than you staying home. And so you've talked a little bit about the dynamics, but like, Travis, what is your like parenting and intentionality compared to Shayla's? You know what I mean? With your having to work throughout the day.
Well, I can tell you I've struggled with it in the past where I would come home from work and man, I'm worn out. I don't really want to do anything. Yeah. I don't feel like messing with the kids. And I've really struggled with that earlier in our marriage. At this point, I've gotten a lot better at how can I be intentional with these kids right now? How can I have fun with them for sure? Because I'm not with them all the time. But how can we learn different things together? How can we have the most? For me, I'm trying to have the most fun I can possibly have. When
yeah,
I'm,
yeah, right.
Because I'm the dad. And I'm supposed to have fun things together.
I love that.
So, but you do have to definitely be intentional about spending time with your kids, especially if you work a lot.
Yeah.
When you're home, man, you got to invest as much as you possibly can.
And put the investment in. I am heartbroken when I hear stories about, like, and I hear all the time about, like, when is school starting? I can't wait to get rid of my kids.
They need to go away.
They don't want their kids around, and that's so sad. And I'm like, well, you just need to work on wanting your kids around. And, like, I heard a story the other day. A woman literally made her daughter ride the school bus home so she would have an extra hour away from her.
Oh.
And I was like, man, the family units are struggling. And self-care is so important. I'm big that you need to make sure you're full. But it's when you take it to extremes, we have parents that are just like, no, I'm tired. This is my self-care time. Like, I just need to be alone. Like, I don't need you. And I'm just like, sometimes it's sacrificial love.
Yes,
Travis will come home and he's exhausted. And he's like, Colin, let's go get your bike and go outside, buddy. You know, or like, hey, Emery, I know our favorite show just came on. They love The Bad Batch and Star Wars. And he's, like, very intentional in what they love.
Yeah.
So he finds something they love, and he intentionally invests time in it. And they'll remember that forever.
Yeah, sometimes it doesn't seem like a lot, but I know even looking back, when somebody invested in me when I was younger, I was like, man, they really spent the time to be there, just to be there in the moment. And that's hopefully that's what it comes out to be, you know,
in the end of the days. Yeah, that's true. So, okay, so we're coming up. What is it? Okay.
I don't want it to stop.
Yeah, no, it's really good. It's really rich stuff for real.
It's so good.
Okay, so here's what I want to do. I want one more thing. We're going to go with you guys and say, what's one thing that you would encourage today's parents, especially parents of teenagers, about intentionality or about, you know, raising up spiritual, God-fearing children? Like, what's the main thing? Like, say, okay, parents, if you keep the main thing, then you never have to worry about struggling. Or, I mean, we're all going to fall short. That's just a given. But what is that major, there are no ifs, ands, or buts about it. This is something that you got to do. It has to happen.
Man, I think for me, honestly, it's being honest with God. Like, being that fully known. Because if I say it's reading the Bible every day, that can turn legalistic.
Yeah.
Where it's like checking off a checkbox. And I don't want you to think that just because you read your chapter every day that you're going to be this super Christian.
Yeah.
But I know 100% if you can just always stay real with God, even in the worst moments, if you're just like, Jesus, help me, then you're going to be fine.
Yeah.
Because it's all about relationship. You know, the one scripture that terrifies me more than any other is that many will cry, Lord, Lord, and he'll say, I never knew you. Like, that seriously wrecks me. And I'm just like, it is all about relationship.
Yeah.
Yeah.
God just wants to, like, be connected to you. I don't think he's sitting there making sure you're checking off all the boxes.
Yep.
So my thing, and that I hope we live out the most, is, like, being just open and real. Like, if you're struggling, tell God about it. Like, if you are hurting, be able to go and be like, hey, God, I do not understand this. I cannot fathom why you would have this in my life right now. But here I am, and I'm just going to wait on you. I'm just going to wait on you.
Wow.
And so that's my biggest thing, because I feel like that's going to keep their relationship the most real.
Sounds a lot like authenticity, doesn't it?
It really does. But
so now you know why they're here, everyone.
These are why they're our friends. Okay.
Yeah. No, but really, yeah, that's it. I think authenticity is, you know, a lot of times we preach leadership, You know, and I think that that's the biggest downfall of Christianity today, just in my opinion, is we're too busy preaching leadership instead of servanthood. Mm-hmm. And we're too busy preaching the look instead of the reality.
Yes.
And so, and that's what the authenticity of it is just a simple fact that it's like, listen, my kids need to know that I'm hitting my knees and seeking God as much as I'm expecting them to.
Yes. 100%.
That's powerful. Wow. Travis, what you got, man?
Oh man. Wow. So for me, I've said it a few times, it'd be about being intentional and not about making it legalistic, but how can you pour in as much as you can possibly pour in with the time that you're given? Because for me, I have limited time during the day, so I have to be so intentional in all the different things that we do. So with your relationships, you have to be super intentional.
Yeah. Mm. Wow.
And for those earlier, I feel like this kept going in my head, so I know it's Holy Spirit. So whenever you're talking about self-care and how you have no problem with self-care, but then like I heard the Lord say in self-care, there's a fine line between selfishness and wisdom.
Yes.
So you can overstep that boundary of wisdom of, hey, I do need to step back for a second. I need to take a deep breath, go to a room for a second, take a breather. Or I'm going to go pawn my kids off to my mom because I can't even look at them for at least 2 days.
Yeah.
So there's a fine line between that wisdom of knowing when you need to step back or you're about to turn into like psycho mom. Or, you know, I don't need to see their face ever again.
Yeah.
100%. Yeah. So there's always that fine line.
No, that's good. That's good. Listen, you guys are amazing, first of all. I just want to say
you
that.
You seriously got us awesome. All hype.
I hope that you guys know that there are people that intentionally watch what you all are doing, because what you hold and value in your home is flowing out, and people that truly get to know you can see that this isn't just talk. Mm-hmm. It's not just a good lesson that you're trying to teach people. You didn't want to come on the podcast to be like, oh, look at how great a parents that we are.
Yeah.
What you do behind the scenes just exudes from you. And so it's very authentic, and you wouldn't be on the show if you weren't. Sorry. But no, I mean, if we haven't asked you to be on the show yet, don't think it's because you're authentic.
That's why.
Anyway,
dang it.
But listen, I wanted to do something. Travis, will you close out today in prayer? Just pray for parents. Pray for especially parents of teenagers and parents that maybe the Holy Spirit has been knocking on the door saying, you know, you need to get your family into, you know, something's got to shift, something's got to change. And just pray for them today, and we'll close out from there.
Yeah. Father, thank you so much for this time, Lord, that we could get together just to talk more about who you are and how we can exemplify who you are in our families' lives. Father, I pray for any parent that's out there today that's listening to this, Father, that you would just lead them, guide them, that you'd give them the wisdom that they need to reach their kid where they're at exactly the way that you reach us exactly where we're at. So, Father, I pray that you just give them the patience to work through situations with their kids and with their families, and that you help them be diligent and just intentional about relationships. And those relationships are specifically focused on who you are. So, Father, we love you. We praise you. We thank you in advance for what you're going to do in families' lives. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, bro. Oh, listen, so everyone, thank you for joining us today. Thank you for tuning in, whether you're on YouTube or Anchor or Apple Podcasts. We don't care. I hope that you're blessed by what Travis and Shayla were sharing today. And we'll see you
next week.
Right
bye
here,
guys.
Same place.
Love ya.
Hey, say bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye-bye.
Say bye-bye.
Say bye-bye.
Oh, okay. Bye-bye.